chapter of Matthew, verses 13 through 17. Then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and yet you come to see me." But Jesus answered him, "Let it be so now. For it is proper for us in this way to fulfill all of God's righteousness." Then he consented. And when Jesus had been baptized down into the water, just as he had come up from the water, suddenly the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven called out, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." May God add his blessing to the reading, the hearing, the understanding, and the warming of all of our hearts as we come to full knowledge of what God has in store for us from this, the Word of God, for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You know, as I started into my study and reflection on this gospel reading on the baptism of Jesus, it is something that we are well acquainted with, that he has a cousin named John the Baptist, whose singular role was to be the prophetic voice calling out to the wilderness, "Prepare the way for the one who is coming, who is greater than I." The one who had the ability to speak with prophetic voice even before he was out of the womb, kicking Elizabeth's stomach so that all who could see it would understand that John the Baptist's message was, "Hey, pay attention." And then we have this role of the one who, in the midst of the world, in his own unique quality, had people gravitating towards him. Some people coming because they wanted to see the circus act that was known as the sideshow, John the Baptist. Because he was such an eccentric and odd and unique and loud, outspoken mountain man of a guy that they wanted to come and see. And yet when they came and saw, they were moved by him, inspired by him, to find themselves making their way down into the water. And the role that John the Baptist played was such a unique one, because what we first heard about the water of baptism comes out of an understanding that John the Baptist was doing something completely different than what our understanding of baptism is today. Because John the Baptist was taking the water, and his understanding was, you're repenting of something, and so you want to symbolically cleanse yourself of that. It's a holy bath, so to speak. And here we have Jesus who appears on the scene, and he immediately says to John the Baptist, "Hey, I've got to go down into the water." John the Baptist is standing there, whoa. I am not good enough to bathe you. It should be the other way around. I know who you are. You're holy. You're the Messiah. You're the Son of God. You're the King of Kings. And Jesus said no. Now, in this moment, whether we realize it or not, We begin to see the fullness of what Jesus' role, character, and life is all about, because he is truly the living, divine incarnation of God. And you've heard this fancy word, and I've given you my description in the past, but if we don't continue to hear it, then we miss the point of it. Jesus came to be fully human and fully God. And it was necessary for us to have that in order for us to have a true understanding and a true relationship. Because guess what? If we just talk about God in a fashion that it's a thing, it's a foreign substance, it's something that we'll never gravitate towards nor understand, we miss the mark. God wants to be so relational with us that he comes all the way down and takes on human form in the person of Jesus, so that we actually have someone that we can point to and say, he's done it. So can I. We have someone that we can point to who lived through all of our temptations. We have someone that we can point to who lived through our punishment. We have someone who we can point to who lived beyond death in resurrection. We have someone that we can point to who shows us what baptism by the Holy Spirit is all about. Because if we simply look at baptism as merely being like taking a bath, then we miss out on everything. If we merely see baptism as being a drop of water, then we miss out on the floods and the rich blessings that overwhelm us and fill us. Because in every ocean, in every sea, in every river, in every stream, in every creek, in every spring, it starts with a drop. God's holy inspiration is that he wells up for us. Those words that are spoken as Jesus was plunged down into the water, he had no need to be bathed or washed from his sins because he was sinless. He had no need to be cleansed because he was not dirty. He had no need to be reminded of righteousness because he was never unrighteous. He never had to face redemption because he had no need to be redeemed. He never had to be forgiven because he was perfect. And yet, he shows us the way personally for what it means. And when Jesus went down into the water and came up, remember, whether it's an ocean, a sea, a lake, a river, a stream, a creek, a spring, or a drop, the Holy Presence is there. Because it only takes one little bit of holiness to change it all. So when Jesus came up out of that water, it says the heavens opened and the voice of God came in the midst of the winged flight of a descending dove and says these words, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." I was stuck on that phrase, well pleased. Because I'm immediately in the midst of this water, the wells that spring up, It reminded me of a camp song that I learned as a kid. I've got a river of life flowing out of me. I've got a river of life flowing out of me. That river of life becomes the well. That no matter what goes on in my life, I can tap down into. But you know, I also then started thinking about that word. That one word. Because we hear well. And depending on what we're involved with, it might mean a well that we get water from. But you know, if you've ever taken some time and actually looked at a dictionary, because I did that. I just simply threw into Google, well, meaning of the word. And it's fascinating. Well, adverb, in a good or satisfactory way. In a way that is appropriate to the facts or circumstances. So as to have a fortunate outcome. In a kind way. With praise or approval. With equanimity. Profitably. Advantageously. In a condition of prosperity or comfort. So believing in God gives us the adverb. Well, all of those things. We live in a good or satisfactory way through God. In a way that's appropriate to the facts or circumstances. God's truth always comes to the surface. So as to have a fortunate outcome. In God, there is only goodness and grace and mercy and peace. In a kind way, with praise or approval, with equanimity. In God, we are made equal. Profitably and advantageously, God takes our brokenness and gives us something new. A second adverb, in a thorough manner. God knows us so thoroughly, so intimately, so closely, that there is no difference that comes from it. Then you look at well as being an adjective. Like, that comes from good health. I don't feel very well. Or in a satisfactory state or position, being sensible or advisable. Having God be our well means that we are given good health or recovered from illness or made into a satisfactory state or position or having our sensibility or our advisability. It comes from God's wellness, not from our own. Or as an exclamation, if you've ever thought about it. Well! Isn't God supposed to be our exclamation? Exactly. Isn't God supposed to be the thing that awakens us and challenges us and shows us? It's more than just the well that we think of, meaning where our water comes from. But even if you think about that, it's a shaft sunk down into the ground, the earth, the dirt that brings up the freshness. Isn't that what God does for us? Digs down, mines down, uncovers beneath the surface of our own filth, an opportunity for freshness and new life to come out. When we look at more than just the simple meaning of a word, there's so much more involved with it than just that. Because where my mind was, maybe it was just any attention to detail in that moment of hearing well. What does it mean to be a well-pleased What does it mean for God to look at us and say, well, with a question, or an exclamation, or even the adjectives, or the adverbs, or the nouns? Because friends, brothers, sisters, what God asks of us is this: I want you to be for me, with me, in me, by me, through all of those aspects of your life. Whatever the adjectives, adverbs, verbs, nouns, prepositions, whatever those things are that make you up in your life, in your livelihood, in your day-to-day walk, God wants to be every single one of those things. Which is where the challenge comes for us as we talk about what does it mean to live into that walk of faith? Because today marks the beginning of Jesus' effective ministry out into the world. That's what the baptism, the celebration of Jesus' baptism is about, because it's in the opening up of the skies, the descension of the dove and the voice that calls out, that begins the utmost important aspect of our walk in faith. Because, you know, it's interesting. I had one of those questions asked of me this past week. So, which do you think is more important in the walk of our church? The Christmas holiday or the Easter holiday? Is it the beginning of Jesus' life that we mark, or is it the death and resurrection of Jesus' life? Are we more Christmas people or more Easter people? You know, the more I thought about that and reflected on it, God wants to be the everyday, ordinary people. God wants us to be the people of our faithfulness, keeping Christ in our Christianity every single day with clarity of vision. Not just on Christmas, not just on Easter. He wants to be the God of our everyday. He wants to be the God of every Sunday in between those holidays. He wants to be the God of every day of your life. He wants to be the God of the seconds in your moment when you are sleepless. He wants to be the God of the seconds when you are struggling. He wants to be the God of the seconds when you are doing right. He wants to be the God of your seconds when you are down in the ditch. He wants to be the God of the seconds when your life isn't going quite right. He wants to be the God of the seconds when things aren't at their best and you're at your wit's end. He wants to be the God of the seconds when everything just seems to be going right and you've got the Midas touch and everything's turning to gold. He wants to be the God when you are struggling so deep in your own sinful nature that you have nowhere else to turn but Him. And that's what that sense of Him going all the way down into the depths of your heart so that He can well up. He wants to mine. He wants to dig. He wants to scratch down into the hardened surface of your heart, of your life. And He wants to make something new. It's not just a message for the sin-sick soul that we want to point our finger at. It's the message of the sin-sick soul that we see in the mirror. Because when Jesus went to John the Baptist and John said, I'm not good enough to do this for you, Jesus' answer is, I'm doing this for you. Take that in. When Jesus says, I must go down in the water, John the Baptist's response, our response is, God, you're too good. You are too good. And Jesus' response is the one that changes our world, our lives, our hearts. I'm doing this for you. Everything Jesus did, everything God does, is for you. Which creates a new vision for us with clarity. With some 2020 understanding, if we take our scriptures and we start reading into this, what does it mean when we hear the voice of God calling out in verse 17 and says this? You. State your name. You. State your name. Say your name.
Come on.
Did you hear your name? Okay. You are my child. You are my child. You are beloved. And I am well pleased with you. Can you imagine God looking at you? Because that's what he's doing. That's what God wants to do right here in this moment. God wants to look at you personally with nobody else around. And he wants to invest himself so much in your life that he's saying to you, Beulah, you are a child of God. Beloved, I am well pleased in you. Ken, you are a child of God. Beloved, and I am well pleased in you. When we all of a sudden have that kind of relationship with our God, it changes everything, doesn't it? And that's what our God wants us to do. He wants to pick up our scriptures and breathe new life into it in a new fashion. So if we're not reading our lives into these holy words, we're missing the holiness of what he says by saying, this is my living word. Because that's what Jesus wants to do for us. That's what God does through the Holy Spirit's inspiration of our scriptural readings, teachings, and understandings. So friends, brothers, sisters, we're supposed to pick up our Bibles, brush off the dust, blow some of the cobwebs off, and start reading it with a freshness of our soul. Because God says, this is your story. This is your message. This is your life. That's why Jesus went down into the water, into the well, into the spring, so that he could be well pleased with you. And when we create so much callousness and hardness and difficulty and dirt and filth, our God doesn't stop there. Because he's got more than enough shafts, more than Gene has in his whole surplus, to dig way down deep to find exactly what it is that needs to come out. We have a God who says, I will find your ability. I will find your salvation. We just need to move out of the way. We need to be the ones who hear him calling out to us. Okay, Lord, you're doing this for me. Here I am. And you will be well pleased. Let God dig down deep into your heart today. This is the moment when he wants to be your everything. And he wants to be the living water that springs forth, quenching you, taking your thirst, bathing you, washing you, surrounding you, encouraging you, and making you into something new. Let us pray that God has his way in us, with us, for us, by us, today. Let's pray. God, it is with your rich blessing that we come. Lord, we are nothing without you. And yet we want to have you breathe new life into these scriptures for us. When we celebrate the baptism of Jesus, when we celebrate our own understanding of what it means to be a baptized member doesn't matter if it's a drop or an ocean. It doesn't matter if we're a baby or an adult. What matters is who did it first. In fact, we also acknowledge that, like a prisoner on the cross, even if we don't have the water touching us, your heart embraces us. And so, Lord, we live for you. When we hear you calling out, sinner, come home, and we are forgiven. So, Lord, let this be a hospital for sinners, where we all come home, whole, well, and healed. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray. And all God's people say, amen. If you're able, then may we stand as we join together our final hymn of Spirit Song, number 347. 347. Let's stand for it. Grace, mercy, peace, hope, joy, and love.